Transportation allows us to move very fast everywhere, but imagine you just hop on a capsule or a train and you can go from San Francisco to LA in 30 minutes.
The Hyperloop combines all of the advantages of all of our current modes of transport that we know today. It's on demand, it's direct, it's energy efficient, it's emission free. It would shrink distances between cities, between countries, between continents in a way that has never been done before. What people might not realize today is that this new mode of transportation will have an impact in their daily lives. There hasn't been any revolution in the transportation system in over 100 years, and it's happening as we speak.
Here we are in the laboratory of EPFLoop. This lab is part of the School of Electrical Engineering. Everything that you see here is always moving because people are coming, making prototypes, testing. One of the most interesting props that comes from the 80s is this levitating plate. Basically, here there are coils inside this structure, and the magnetic field is created by these coils. And if we start basically the motor of this coil, you can see that it's levitating. We can use these systems in a bigger scale, and that's also where the Hyperloop enters in the equation.
The Hyperloop is a new mode of transportation that would carry passengers or cargo. They would be loaded into the Hyperloop pod, which would then accelerate via electric propulsion in a low-pressure vacuum tube. The pod is fully autonomous. It is also protected from weather hazards and is clean in the sense that it has no direct carbon emissions.
It's kind of having an airplane without wings, similar as a flying train.
As we speak today in the US, there are projects that are being concretely developed and that aim to connect major cities. One example would be LA to San Francisco in about 30 to 40 minutes. You can actually connect the East Coast to the West Coast in a little under 5 hours.
Right now, the train system in US is not at its best, and having something that is as simple as taking the train, hop on iPod, can revolutionize the future of transportation in the same way that mobile phone revolutionized the way we connect.
So if we want to look at the impact that it would have on our economy today, we can take, for example, cargo transportation. There's a study that says that the e-commerce will be worth around $4 trillion in the next 2 years. And a Hyperloop-enabled cargo transport would really make it possible to transport goods at the speed of flight and at the cost of trucking.
It will be very easy for everybody to take it because it will be something like another train, just faster, way faster.
We get our inspiration from a project that started out in 1974 and then was undertook by a team of professors right here at EPFL, in fact, right here in this lab, that is called the Projet Suisse Metro. They estimated that by the time that the regulatory push would be socially accepted around 2020. And well, here we are, 2 years away from the post-deadline, and we see companies such as Virgin Hyperloop announcing that they would like to have fully functional, full-scale Hyperloops by mid-2020. I guess they were quite
precise.
Yeah, precise in their forecasts. I mean, it's only 30, 40 years ago, right?
Yep.
But we are also facing the same types of congestions on the roads, airports, ports. The Swiss Metro is really anchored in our project's DNA and in this school's DNA. Having such a pioneering project that was developed right here on campus is a huge advantage for us in order to really develop further our project and accelerate the future of transportation known as the Hyperloop today.
There was not that global reception as now with Elon Musk. And probably that's also the reason why it didn't have enough traction to get there.
Back in 2013, Elon Musk published his white paper on Hyperloop Alpha. And there was this general wave of excitement around this promising new technology. 2 years later, they decided to expand this research contest to universities. The idea is to make it possible for students and young engineers around the world to really contribute to the development of the open source knowledge around the Hyperloop and make it more challenging, seeing as it's a competition.
The Hyperloop competition has the objective of creating the fastest pod inside the tube that is located at SpaceX headquarters in Lausanne, in California.
We go through different steps of validation along the entire process to make sure that quality of the engineering that we are sending as reference to SpaceX is top-notch and that our prototype is safe and is worthy of entering the SpaceX vacuum tube.
And so slowly you start developing like this willingness to create something new. And then in January, we received the news that we were actually invited to go to LA. So everybody was super pumped. And we said, okay, let's go, let's do this. At the competition, we finished third.
Third in the world is a very good score. And so now people are starting to hear about us, and even better, they're excited to hear about the project and even try to help if they can.
3, 2, 1.
La question c'est pourquoi on va pas au max? Parce que le rail il est pas vissé dans le sol. Si on va au max, le rail il part avec le pod.
This is a science fair organized by EPFL. This is the same pod that we took to California that has been traveling, I don't know, many thousands of kilometers. I'm excited because it's the first time that we actually have a direct interaction with the public. We have been always working in our lab and then going to California, and the things were moving so fast that we didn't have time to show everybody what we were doing.
Safety is really the number one priority when it comes to designing the Hyperloop. Demonstrating that it's technologically feasible is one step, but still you need to make sure that the people are ready for this kind of technology.
At the beginning, you're like a fan of the project, then you became like supporter of the project. At this point, I feel like I'm kind of obsessed with the project.
There are a lot of factors that you have to take into account that are not directly related to the technology itself that you're developing. There's a lot of work that comes from developing hand-in-hand with the government and regulatory entities a legal framework that would make it safe and scalable, really, to implement this technology. In the case of Swiss Metro, the project was kind of too far ahead in its time, and there wasn't really an actual demand for this way of transportation. There needs to be some kind of social acceptance. You need to feel comfortable walking into the Hyperloop, trusting this technology to get you from point A to point B, kind of at the speed of light.
The possibility of making the distance between two different places so short that you can just jump on the Hyperloop and then in 20 minutes you are across the country, it's amazing and it's a very inspiring opportunity.
Imagine a world in the future that is smaller, greener, and connects people in a way that we've never witnessed before.